Hi, everyone. Welcome to Phoenix Rising. I hope you're all doing well and enjoying the beginning of spring, which starts later today, I think tonight, right? Yes, I'm getting the nod over here from Kevin. No, Kevin, I was over here. I have Leaf over here. I'm so excited to have these guys. Get ready for some fun conversation and wonderful music. And I'm going to have the guys also tell you how to get in touch with them. So without any further ado, I'm going to start with you, Leaf. Ta-da!
Ta-da!
There he is.
So
I'm glad you're here.
Thank you. Glad to be here. Thank you. Thank you for having us. So Leif Erickson Lewis, Kevin D. Cummings.
Yes!
My partner in crime.
How long, man?
We are collectively Deep Freeze. Deep Freeze is a name that was coined some 50 years ago when we were but wee lads. And it was our first band. 50 years ago, we were in our first band together. So
you could have said 30.
It was just the two of you at that time?
No, there it was four of us. There were four of us. One has passed.
Yeah.
And the other one has...
other things going on.
He's got other things going on.
He stays busy.
So we were talking a lot about spirituality and music and rhythm before the show began. So I'm going to do a segue and probably interrupt you both a million times. So with the member of Deep Freeze that passed, whenever you're practicing or playing, do you ever get a sense that they're present with you? Or that the energy, yes, Kev?
I would like to say that. Andre Boyce, may he rest in peace.
May he rest in peace.
Was an integral part. He was the reason how we all hooked up.
Yeah.
Okay.
We knew each other for a long time because we were out in the parks playing basketball.
Okay. Out in Nassau, Suffolk, Queens.
Brooklyn.
What were we talking? I'm a Brooklyn girl too.
Yeah.
Brooklyn.
But
New York.
None of us knew our musicianship, our love for music at all.
Right. Right.
Until it was he that invited us over, you know, to his place. And upon he arrives, I'm like, wait, you play music? I play music? Same thing for all of us.
Yeah. Right.
Unfortunately, our dear friend Andre had passed at a very young age. He was like 32, maybe.
32, I think, yeah.
You know, from some sort of cancer.
Cancer.
And in that time, and even in that time, for whatever reason, he felt his destiny was a little bit different than the Deep Freeze concept,
mm-hmm.
and was branching off and stopped with the band. So there were some tensions there, as a result of that.
Yeah.
But during that time, during his waning years, it was all love and it was all respect.
Yeah.
And
he had a mission when he came here. We all do.
Yeah,
absolutely.
You know, and he completed his.
Absolutely. And for that reason, you could say he helped us to move forward with what.
Thank you for sharing that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because it helps people to know.
No
matter what the age, but I'm leaning there thinking young people, you know, that don't know where they're going, don't know what they want to do. Do you have a talent? What's going on? Take a chance. Do something.
It is. It's a funny thing.
Step out of your comfort zone.
Yeah. It's a funny thing even with a lot of the youth that we've run into, you know, as we became of age. Me personally, like I never studied a day in grade school or high school. Why? I just wanted to play music. I wanted to draw. I wanted to do. I knew I was going to be an artist of some sort. Don't get it wrong. I never failed any of my classes. My parents weren't having that. But the problem with me was like my two older brothers, Richard and Wayne, were like A students all the time. So every time
that was a high bar.
Yes, report card send to mom. I was like.
Yeah, I used to sweat a lot on those things.
You can't get an A. Why can't you get a 90? Sorry, Mom, but but that was it. But you know, as long as we you know didn't fail, that was it.
Yeah, a really amazing journey.
It becomes something of a story to tell when you are still healing from the scars.
Yeah, years ago, when way before COVID, I used to do a lot of adult education classes in the mm-hmm. evening. And I don't know if you ever met Sakani. He's from Peru, and he plays beautiful, the wooden flutes and some drums. Yeah. And I would do different workshops, like the masks that we wear, a lot mm-hmm. of Reiki and meditation workshops. And two things that are, I guess I'm very passionate about, is to educate people about death and dying, and you don't have to pass out of this world in abject fear. So I trained to be an Anamkara, midwife to the dying, to help, because it's all in rhythm. And even passing out of this physical body is a rhythm. It doesn't have to be a terrible thing of hard chords. It can be gentle and calm, and have someone hold your hand here as you step there, because someone's there to greet you there. So with doing these workshops, I talked to Sakani and I asked if he would accompany me on this journey at this library, North Shore Library, because I wanted to do a workshop on the rhythms of our life. Because many years ago, and people know this, many years ago when I was a flower child, a hippie, I had smoked a little something, and I was up at my friend's apartment right off Central Park West. We're sitting out on this little brick thing, and we had music playing. And as I was watching the people cross the street, my view, my vision, my hearing was they were moving to the music we were hearing. Mm. And it was then, and that's maybe 1967, 65, somewhere around there, it was everything in our body, everything in your life, everything is a rhythm.
Yes.
How we each breathe, we all breathe. Your rhythm is different than your rhythm, mm-hmm. even though you're together so long. My rhythm is different than my children's or anyone else's. How I move my hands when I speak is a different rhythm. How I walk is a different rhythm. My speech is a different, my affect is all, it's all a different, beautiful rhythms, all making this tapestry of me in this lifetime. So when I had all these beautiful people, some sitting in chairs, some sitting on yoga mats, and they said, we all have different rhythms. And you know, people in class, nobody really wants to get up and be the first one that the teacher calls on. So I said, here's the rhythm of how I walk. No music yet. Just watch. I'm going to walk and how my hands move and just be me. So I walk across the front of the room and they were like, all right, cool. That's her rhythm. And I said, okay, who wants to go? Who's next? And it was like, oh, heck. And it was, please do it. Do it for you, just so you could each see.
Release that part of yourself.
And it was so beautiful, guys, to see maybe there were 20, 25 people in the room. Everyone moved differently. So then Sakani started to play. And everybody moved around the room. Some moved their hands. Some were very inhibited at first. But then when they saw no one was judging them,
right,
it was unconditional love and acceptance of the rhythm of who we are. And there was a rhythm here before the show started. There's a rhythm here now.
Yes.
And it just, when you think of your life as a rhythm, to me it moves so much more effectively, smoothly.
It's less stressful.
And sometimes you do have those heavy, frightening chords. But you know what? It's a choice how you handle that chord.
You know, it's just like walking or anything like that, even on an instrument, even though there could be 20 people could play this same instrument right here, but each person is going to play it differently.
Their energy being put into that.
Even if you give them the song to play, each one will play it differently.
My first drum lesson was beyond a blessing to me. My first drum lesson was Baba Alatunji.
Brooklyn.
So I fell in love with him when I was a kid. He came here and Murray the K was the first one to play drums of passion. Remember that one? And I felt like when that music played, I guess I couldn't speak. My parents didn't know what the heck happened to me. But I knew I needed to hear that sound. I needed to be part of that music. So I said, I need drums. Come on, you're a white Jewish girl in Kew Garden Hills. What are you talking about, a drum? So they didn't understand djembes, right? Neither did I, and had never seen a djembe, but they were good. They went out and they bought me bongos.
Okay, well, right,
it was a step. And I used to hang out in Rockaway. So I went down to Rockaway with my bongos, didn't tell my parents where I was going, and I met these guys that were so good to me. Mixed media guys, every shape, every size, every color, every ethnicity. And they took this kid in, and they gave me some basics on the bongos. Yeah,
well, they recognized your appetite for the medium.
It was, I almost cried when I heard Baba, especially the first time. And then through the years, I always made a point of finding him, listening to him. And in, I guess it was the mid-80s, I'm working at this doctor's office, and a friend said to me, "Do you want to go get a drum lesson from Baba Olatunji?" Mm-hmm. It was, wait a minute, Baba Michael Olatunji?
Right.
Please, the Yoruban gentleman.
That guy.
And it was like, yes. So a number of people, I didn't know one was his godson, and Daniel Bailey. And so we went to this church in Nassau, Suffolk County line. And someone loaned me a djembe, and I sat there. And this man walked in, and everyone got silent. And he didn't raise his voice above this. And this is how he taught. Godo, just pata. You know, all his words, his language, his drum language. So I got to take my first drum lesson for him. I got to dance for him, Fanga. He taught me that dance, the welcoming dance. And there was such a connection that he took me. When class was going on, he took me on the side and he said, "You are my child, you are my daughter. You will do well." And then my sweetheart, Scott, who has since passed away, and you remember this, honey, Scott walked in and he took Scott. He said, "You be good to her because I am her father now."
Okay.
And he adored Scott.
Right.
And I went to Baba's Going Home, Riverside Chapel had it when he passed away. And the people that showed up for all over the world, especially the different countries in Africa, and the different outfits and
ceremonial dress.
Oh my God, the ceremonial dress was beyond your wildest dreams. Mickey Hart was there. He led the drumming procession. And I know Baba is still with me. So, like you were talking about other people before, and just the people that we come across, the lightheartedness.
Yeah.
It's just amazing.
Yes. Yes. Well, if you can accept it as such, I think we are here to reflect love one toward the other. I'm focusing on the concept of reflecting the love. Because very often we think we're showing love to someone, but we're showing love the way we would want to receive love, which is not necessarily how they want to accept it.
And they might not even acknowledge it that way. It's foreign to them.
Exactly. So I say reflect love, hoping that the love that you show someone will reflect back to you, and the love that they show you, you can reflect back to them.
Yeah.
So it's a like-mindedness, not necessarily an agreeing.
Right.
Coming from different sides. But there is an acceptance of a like-mindedness, of a desire to be whole with this new experience.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
And like we were talking before the show, that thing about music. Okay, so we're musicians. So we've been doing this a long time. And, I first started doing music because Sly and the Family Stone released a record called There's a Riot Going On.
Mm-hmm.
And the music on that album woke me up.
Okay.
And I became aware of music as a powerful force in the world because of the power of what that music was doing to me.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, we don't want to call it protest music or whatever, but it was...
It stirred in you.
Yes, it was a call to action, a call to think. There's a tune on there called Stand.
Mm.
And in the end, you'll still be you. One that's done all the things you set out to do. Stand. Don't you know that you are free? Well, at least in your mind, if you want to be.
Gotcha.
So yeah. There were, music took on a purpose. Music moved people.
Yeah.
You know, I used to be a guitar player back when I didn't know any better.
My boy. Kevin's thinking payback's coming.
Kevin knows. I used to be a guitar player. But what had happened was I played in a band and
a happy one too.
Yeah. You know, I was Hendrix. The bandana, yes. The whole thing, play guitar. I was in a band with a bass player, and this bass player rocked the house. And I learned in high school, in this high school band, that when the bass player is grooving, all the girls are grooving. So I switched to bass because
That was a problem.
Because the reality,
you had some sewing to do.
No, it wasn't so much the sewing, but I wanted to be in control of what was moving the bowels of the crowd.
Okay.
I was also DJing at the time, so listening for the beat and getting people to do what you know. As a bass player, when the bass player changes, the song changes and the energy changes, and you know. So I switched to bass, and I still play a little guitar. He's much better at it than I am. So, you know, that's not my arena anymore.
Look at his face.
He's much better.
Well, we have an ironic story, though, you know, behind, you know, the reason I came into music also was that, I loved music, but, you know, I was hopelessly a shy kid.
Oh, yeah.
In high school. Even all through high school.
This is a great venue for the shy ones here, including myself.
You know, and so I also do painting. I'm an artist. I do charcoals, animation, and the whole nine. But all of that is basically you're alone. You're by yourself pretty much when you do that. And I just happened to be taking up guitar by myself also. And it wasn't until my mother would come in. Oh, you're sounding good. Hey, let me bring your aunt so and so. Hey, listen to Kevin play. And once that happened, I was like,
you lock up.
You know, so I had to come to grips with myself. So like, the better I was getting on this instrument, I can't. You know, I have to be able to come out and do that. So I had to get over that.
How do you get over it? I still do that with my drums.
Well, there's a point.
I feel comfortable when I'm by myself in the house or on the back porch. But if I'm in a drum circle, I'm really happy. But when you go around and you do each person, I still freeze after all these years.
Well, there's a point where you have to get past, because there's tension in learning something. There's frustration to get over the hill. And it's only until you get past that, knowing your instrument, that you'll start to feel like you'll get that, hey, look what I can do, kind of the childlike thing in there.
Okay.
So, and that kind of did it for me. It just, after a while, it came about. So after a while it was.
Time for us to stop talking.
You know, you're comfortable. You know, and so that helped me out a lot coming into music, and that helped get me out of that shy period. Sometimes I tell people, I was unbelievably shy, and they never believe me. They're like, you, but no. And then once I got past that, it just, you open up, you blossom.
Okay. Okay.
It's like coming of age and when you learn to drive a car. Mm-hmm. And there used to be a commercial from the U.S. Auto Club. I don't know. You start to live when you learn to drive. And it, you know.
Hello,
and,
yes.
And when you learn to drive an instrument, it's pretty much the same thing, you know.
So I think he learned to drive a different way when he was part of a touring band, the Tom Brown Funking for Jamaica touring band.
Age 22.
Because there was a big record, Funking for Jamaica. Tom Brown, look it up, Google it, whatever,
I will.
Whatever, you know the record. It's a big record. And he was a young man on the road touring with Tom Brown. And this shy kid had to step up on big stages and play. And, you know, I didn't go on tour, but I would see him when he came back. And he was becoming more emboldened. He was becoming more
that blossom
front facing, as opposed to the guitar player who was standing facing the side.
Yeah.
Yeah, but you were still getting all the girls.
That bass player stuff.
I didn't.
Okay, so we can edit that, right? Okay, so here we go. So what happens is now is that he's also a remarkable piano player. His talent is remarkable. You know, you see that those big hotels in Dubai, the Burj, the one that looks like the sale. This guy played piano, grand piano, top floor. He's the guy. He's that guy.
Okay.
Thank he's God that music. Guy. He's I didn't ask guy. To do that.
Just, he's that guy.
That was
you know what? We're humbled by these blessings.
And this is the thing. If you can, okay, so because of the arc of the path, yeah? When you recognize what should have taken you out, what should have killed you, all the things that you dodged in order to be here in this moment, if you can start off the day with an attitude of gratitude, then maybe you learn a little something before the day is over.
Our conversation the other day.
I'm just saying, you know what I mean? So.
I know them.
Yeah, so I caught myself in the mirror here. Wow, okay.
Yeah. Would you guys play something and then we'll talk some
Yes,
more.
Yes, yes, let's play something. Let's play something.
Yeah?
We're going to play, Kev.
How about, we're kind of in a mellow stage right now.
Mm-hmm.
That would be appropriate for that. You might have remembered that. Again. Tell me if you remember this. Thank you. cherish you. It's our life.
Yeah.
It's what we need to, we need more of that.
Yes.
We do.
We need more of that in people. And I don't mean just, I mean around the world.
Yeah. So when you sit with people, take the time and listen to just church, just
talking.
The song just now, to not be doing anything else, to mindfully be there in the moment. And listen to the musicians, listen to the message, listen to their energy coming through whatever instrument it is that they are working with as an extension of their heart, their soul, their core.
Thank you. Perfect.
Because it's, you don't just have a piece of wood on your leg with strings, with brass, with copper, whatever. It's, to me, it's more of an extension of each of you. What are you giggling about over here?
It's more than just a piece of wood on his leg. I said,
No, I figured I had to get out of that one really fast. I'm thinking, no. How do I get out of that?
The family shout.
I knew one of you was going to get it. I didn't think. I figured, he's not going to call me.
Whatever.
That's why it's like Lindsay said, the show is organic. Many times, at least one of us, usually me, sticks foot in mouth. You know what I meant, smarty pants.
Yes.
So now you're going to come across somebody that's going to bring that up to you.
It's all right.
You say, sure, but not in public, you know.
Sure.
I have stuck my foot in my mouth many times on this show.
Of course, you. So.
Tell me what that is.
If you can read my mind.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Just like an old time movie, out of ghosts and a machine wheel, in a castle dark or a fortress strong, chains upon my feet. You know that ghost is me, and I will never be set free as long as I'm a ghost. You can't see. If I could read your mind, love, what a tale your thoughts would tell. Just like a paperback novel, the kind the drugstore sells. When they get to the pawn, where the heartache comes, the hero would be me. Heroes often fail. You won't read that book again, because the ending's just too hard to take. Like a movie star who gets burned in a three-way script. Oh, enter number two. A movie queen to play the scene of bringing all the good things out in me. But for now, love, let's be real. I never thought that I could act this way. Say that I just don't get it. I don't know where we
feeling gone, and I just can't get it back.
So sweet. Thank you.
I miss that kind of music too.
Yeah.
You don't hear it enough.
As you got to the part with Ghost. Yeah, so people could see.
It was in the script.
We scripted this. And I'm like, well, that's really interesting.
So there's, you know, that song. So the song Cherish, you know, obviously we were young people when those music originally hit the airwaves. But music has a way of burning itself to a memory and then finding a place to hide in your brain. So that when that song comes up again, the memories associated with when you learned the song, when it became, takes you right back. It's a time machine. So, you know, I'm grateful to have grown up in a time where live musicians made music that was so impactful. And how should I say this? Educated you without insulting you. Too much of today's music, I find insulting. I'm not mentioning genres or anything, but I just find it insulting, okay? Because like, there is a dumbing down of music. There's a dumbing down of everything.
There is.
And I don't like the dumbing down, okay? Because there's beauty in intricacy. There's beauty in the classical music, in the Beethovens. There's beauty in the multiplicity of ingredients.
When you listen to and close your eyes and visualize Vivaldi, The Four Seasons, those four pieces were used by Dr. Emoto in the study of the healing of water. Because we are
all water, a lot of water.
We're all water. And it was, I guess, in about 1997 that Dr. Masui Emoto came out with his book, Messages from Water. And music flows, water flows. And we did an experiment in the doctor's office I worked at Stony Brook. Because Dr. Emoto was saying, water is a living thing. When we speak to each other and you do harsh words, it impacts you, that vibration. So we did this experiment, and I'll try to keep it really quick. So we had patients that would come back like on a 3-week rotation in the medical office I was in. So we took post-it notes on the back of the water cooler and wrote things like love, peace, you are beautiful, you are precious, you could do anything, all these wonderful
affirmations.
Yes. And put it on the back, and patients would come in when I would take them in for their EKG or whatever. I'd say, here, have a cup of water. Nom, 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 everybody's drinking the water. When the same group of patients were coming back 3 to 4 weeks later, sadly, and we had to do a clearing on this afterwards, we changed the messages on the bottle of water. You are ugly. You are worthless. But all these terrible things. Just to see what was going to happen. Part of Dr. Emoto's messages.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Every single person said, the water doesn't taste good.
Oh, wow.
Did you change water companies? So what they did with Vivaldi's music is Dr. Emoto in his laboratory, he has since passed, and the darling lady Michiko Hayashi has carried on his work. He and Dr. Emoto, who I had a crush on for the longest time. Watch this now, and I'm out of the closet on that one. But what they did was they took drops of water, froze them, and played different types of music to them. When they played the Four Seasons, each frozen drop took on the characteristics of that season.
Wow.
When they played very aggressive music, the frozen flake became distorted. When they put the words hate, ugly, I don't like you, on the thing, the white or crystal clear flake turned into like an ugly green brown color and became distorted. Yeah. So, yeah, check it in. Messages from Water. If anyone's
messages
watching.
Messages from Water.
Messages from Water by Dr. Matsui Emoto.
Coincidentally.
Coincidentally.
Wow.
Yeah. It's so, and you will see, and thank, and you could friend Michiko Hayashi on Facebook. I'll link you up with her. She's come to the States. We had her do a presentation at the Buddhist Meditation Center 2 days before we got shut down with COVID.
Yeah.
But we got the message out, and this is, it's all energy. The music, the water, us.
Wow. I'm telling you, it's
how much we learned from each other just sitting and chatting.
I'm loving it. I'm loving it. It's good to be, well, the important thing is to allow yourself to be open to that.
Yeah.
And that's so important, you know. I love it. A leaf is playing something.
Yeah. Let's see. I think you got to go along with this guy now.
Let's see if I remember this. Day will make a way for night. Mm. And all we'll need is candlelight and a song. Soft and long. Glad to be here alone with a lover unlike no other. It's sad to see a new horizon so late coming into view. I wanna be living for the love of you. All that I'm giving is for the love of you.
Damien, look at this face. Yeah, no. maybe.
Well, I know a guy named Gerald, but I don't know. I don't know a person named Gerald Dane.
Yeah, and it's J-E-R-A-L-D. Damien is D-A-E-Y-M-O-N. Okay. And he plays a violin.
Oh, okay. Okay, he's that guy.
Talk about make you cry.
Oh, so the first time that my Scott, before he went to heaven, and I danced together, Gerald Damien did a rendition, no words, of You Make Me Feel Brand New. Ooh. And I hope you get to listen to this gentleman. This was like a
Gerald Damien.
Yeah. J-E-R-A-L-D. And we'll if you want, I'll text it to you later.
We'll definitely
and check on the album cover, he's in like a white dashiki, white gauze pants, sitting on a white pedestal with his violin.
Which is white.
Ooh.
Hmm?
White violin? I'm just
No, violin's brown like he is. Okay, so, well, I mean, so. It was a nice contrast thing.
So he's the guy. He's that guy.
He kicks it. Like Jesse Cook years ago, when I would hear him on the guitar, you know, I would play Jesse Cook over and over and over and over and over again. Yeah.
You know, when I discovered Jesse Cook, I was in Dubai.
Oh.
It was like, well, I fell into it. I fell in love with that style in flamenco.
Yeah.
Can't play it for to save my life. And I just was at a concert like three nights ago to see, I can't remember his last name, but his first name is Diego. And he plays flamenco like, oh my gosh. I cried.
Keep me in the loop on that, because I stopped going to concerts and going out and stuff after COVID. I just didn't get myself back into going out.
Mm.
And I think you, when you stop putting live music in your life, you're really taking so much away from your life.
You really are.
Yeah.
I just miss it. Oh, Leaf, it's killing me here. Let's see. Do it from the top.
Words are really important. Say, Leaf is enlivening me here. Or he's bugging me, whichever. So before we go any further, would you tell anyone watching how to find you? And if you can't find him, find me and I'll help you find him.
Please do.
Yes, well, If you dial 1-800-KNUCKLEHEAD, no, I'm kidding. If he answers, hey,
I can tell you who you're going to find on that one.
Yeah. No, but if you Leif E. Lewis on the Instagram, and I believe.
Oh, I'm not hooked up with you on Instagram yet.
Yeah, I got to do that. Right? I got to do that. So Leif E. Lewis, Kevin D. Cummings, you can find us on the gram. We're hoping. Okay, so full disclosure. I used to play out on the east, out east, wine country, a couple of years ago. And a few years ago, actually. For a few years. And it was a lovely experience. And I'm hoping to be back on the east side.
Absolutely.
Back out here in the wine country playing east with my partner, Kevin, now. Because the reality is we have a... I know that there's a fan base for our music.
Mm-hmm.
Because we play the music that touches our souls. And it's bound to touch yours. So, Leif E. Lewis. That's Leif E. Lewis. And Kevin
D.
D. Cummings.
At yahoo.com. You can find me on Instagram.
Right.
Yeah.
I have a YouTube channel also.
Okay.
And on Facebook. Yeah, you know, Facebook, Instant Messenger. Yeah.
Yeah,
all that. If you use that. So we do duet. We work with drum machines. We have tracks. We also know drummers and other musicians. So if you want to hire more than a duet to play your function.
Absolutely.
We are certainly available to play whatever your function is. We will hire on as necessary.
Absolutely.
Necessary.
And
you're getting so British. Well, or is it Australian?
It's something in my accent. I think I've got a frog in my throat.
Yeah, frog. Good. Okay.
But if we do all kinds of music. We're doing this, but we're sitting to do dance music. And
the first time I met Kevin, Kevin was doing a keyboard.
Yes, he's a keyboard player.
So that's the keyboard.
Yes. He's a keyboard player who happens to play guitar.
Yeah,
this is my first love.
You guys are truly the whole package. Yeah. And just being with them is just wonderful.
Yeah. Loved it.
Yeah, this is so awesome. And y'all come back now, you hear?
No, please.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And thank you to all the staff who have helped to make our stay here so comfortable and enjoyable.
They are wonderful.
And it's a great thing. It's a great thing you've got going on here. Thank you.
Yeah.
Once again, Ms. Venus.
Oh, you will be back.
Oh, I think so. I'm hoping that, you know, somebody calls you and says, excuse me, I'm looking for the gentleman you had on your show.
And LTV puts it out on LTV, and they put it out on the YouTube channel.
Okay, great. We do private functions. Call us.
All the time.
As a matter of fact, 516-435-9511.
Okay, and if you forget that, as I said, reach out to me.
Reach out to Miss Phoenix, sir.
They cut me down, yes. And you're going to find, remember when we talked on the phone the other day, I told you people... had, you know, someone approached me, not someone I'd want to approach me, in Target and said, you know, and they say the name of the show, Phoenix Rising, you know, in Best Buy, man is online behind me when I'm buying a washing machine.
Yeah.
And he says, I know you. And I'm like, oh, no, you don't. But he did.
He recognized you. Doesn't know you.
Recognize me. Very big difference.
And the good thing about this.
And most people don't know me, which is, thank goodness for that.
You know, my first and only granddaughter's name is Phoenix.
Really? Oh, you have to show me a picture.
I was waiting for that to come out. Yes. Feeny.
Then my friend Tracy Hamilton. Did you meet Tracy? She's an amazing drummer.
Quite, yeah.
Tracy Hamilton.
I know you, Tracy.
Yeah. She's just an absolute darling. She came out. She had an appointment with me. Going to take care of something last Saturday at my office. And then she went into town. And she went to Steve at Green Earth Grocers and came across a couple of other musicians that she used to jam with and ended up having a jam outside Green Earth.
Oh, you see? Those are the best. Those are ergonomic. Those are the best.
And we used to do that. And I said to her, there's always a djembe in the trunk of my car There's always a rain stick in the trunk of my car, and there's always a bag with small percussion instruments in the trunk of the car, because you never know. You could go to Snowflake Ice Cream in Riverhead, and there's the gazebo there, and you find a friend like Joe Kaleo sitting in the gazebo by himself with his djembe, and you're like, be right there.
Wow.
So you never know. And we have to make up, and we'll all meet at the gazebo when it gets a little warmer. Guitar, bass, drums. I'll get Tracy to come with her junjuns, and we'll tear it up.
Wow. That would be great out here.
Yes.
That would be great.
So I'm going to say thank you to everyone watching, and thank you so much for supporting the show. And do you have about 3 minutes to take us out with something delicious?
How about Beatles?
Play it.
All right. Again, thank you all so much. Enjoy these two magnificent beings.
Well, we loved it. We loved you.
I love you both.
And therefore, one, two, three. Tell me if you remember this.
Deep breath in. Feel the rhythm of your breath. Feel the vibration of all the beautiful words and sounds you heard on today's show. And let it sink into every cell of your being, making every cell of your being sparkle and shine with this magnificent energy of unconditional love. Be aware of your rhythms. Be aware of the tapestry that you create with every breath and every step you take. My love to all of you. Again, thank you. May the blessings be. Thank you, Leif. Thank you, Kevin. And thank you, you amazing people here at LTV. Thank you.